everyone, and thank you for listening to Brain Foods, the podcast on women changemakers. I'm your host, Hannah Becker, and today I have the great pleasure to introduce you to our first researcher, Jenni Pessi. She's a senior scientist, worked in academia. She got her PhD from the University in Helsinki in 2017. She co-founded a health startup in Finland and has years of experience from pharmaceutical companies. Welcome, Jenni. It's such a pleasure to have you.
Thank you so much for having me.
Jenni, today we're going to talk about how to find scientific innovations in healthcare. But first of all, can you tell us a little bit about your career path?
Sure. So I ended up studying pharmacy because I found it interesting as it combines many different disciplines. I did not originally know that I want to be a researcher, but I got my first position as a research assistant. And then I realized that, oh, actually, this is what I want to do. So I continued with research. I did my master's thesis research in Harvard University. And then I continued with the PhD program in University of Helsinki. Out of that research, there was a spin-off startup company. I was a visiting researcher in a Finnish pharmaceutical company. And then I moved to Denmark to work also in pharmaceutical industry.
Wow. From startup to big organizations. What is a good environment from your experience to foster innovation?
I think you want an interdisciplinary environment where you have people with different backgrounds. It's good to have a bunch of nerds, so people who actually are really into science. So you have people who share a passion, and you can have authentic scientific debates and discuss different scientific topics, so that everybody participating has their own views and can share them very openly.
That makes a lot of sense, at least to me. We can see that with the COVID-19 pandemic particularly, we have an enormous strain placed on the global healthcare sector. We can see that especially low-income families and people of color tend to be less healthy than other members of the population and are more likely to have more than one chronic condition. This, of course, impacts things like life expectancy, quality of life, and earning potential. Intervening earlier and creating more points deep into the communities that enable better access to traditional care, as well as other resources, is really important to drive better health outcomes. There's an enormous need for governments and organizations across the world to address mental and behavioral health issues, especially after the COVID-19 pandemic. Unfortunately, we can see that industry stakeholders face considerable challenges in addressing the large scope of behavioral health crisis. So I would like to talk about with you, we can see that there's a need for innovation, there's a need for cost cutting. What is hampering organizations at the moment to innovate?
I think what has to be taken into account that in the science sector, innovation always takes a little bit more time. So you need to build up teams that have the expertise, and you need to foster these teams to work together and find the solutions and make sure that the scientific ground is already covered. Because if you don't know the field you work at, you don't know what is the innovation you can strive for.
Yeah, we can definitely see that today's socioeconomic, mental and behavioral health crisis have made it quite clear that players across the healthcare landscape need to innovate to better serve the whole health needs of people across the world. Now, if this takes such a long time, is there something that we can do to facilitate the speed of innovation in pharmaceutical companies?
I think it again comes down to teams and also to the fact that, of course, nowadays, major part of the working force is women, but there's still gender biases. Of course, there has been progress has been made. But still, there's a lot that could be done in terms of hearing the female voices in big organizations. And I think it should be also made, or people should be made more aware that we have these subconscious biases against women. So that would be a topic that should be discussed. And then maybe people would also be more willing to give more space to female ideas when they are aware of these subconscious behaviors.
That makes a lot of sense. So to innovate, also to take into account women's needs, is I think what you're kind of alluring to here at the moment. So Jenni, you pointed out here that there is a huge problem with unconscious bias. What can we do to be more conscious about unconscious biases, and how would we stop ourselves from being influenced by it?
I think it makes sense to start from acknowledging the problem and acknowledging that everybody, male and females, have these biases in their heads. And then you can change things with basically everyday behavior. If you have a female colleague who maybe is a little bit insecure, or maybe you have the feeling that maybe they are suffering from a bit of imposter syndrome, maybe you can go and say a nice thing, or like give acknowledgement on what they have done. I think that's where you start. And of course, the more people are aware, the more they can also change their behavior accordingly.
What can we do to be more conscious about unconscious biases? And how would we stop ourselves from being so influenced by it when listening to ideas, particularly coming from women?
So I think generally just being more aware is a good start. So if people are aware that they have often different cognitive biases, they can also then just start changing their behavior. And let's say if women tend to be a bit more critical towards themselves, so maybe make sure in everyday life that you praise your colleagues and acknowledge them for the work they have done, and start changing things from the bottom up.
Changing things from the bottom up seems like a very good approach, especially when we talk about pitching. From your experience, is there any example that you could give us where we can maybe even use the fact that women are a bit more critical with their own work for pitching ideas in the healthcare industry?
Yeah, I've been to quite a few startup events, and often, of course, you hear really good stories where people have an idea and they present the impact, and then they present how it's done, and maybe then they mention some risks and limitations in the end. But I would like to have this actually done reverse, because then you could actually take advantage of being critical towards your own ideas and being aware how much of an impact you could do. So I would start reverse pitching. So I would first tell actually what are the limitations, what are the risks, what are the challenges. It also, I think, proves if the person speaking actually understands their topic, yeah, and knows what it can do. Because if you don't know the limits, you also really don't know the opportunities. And after that, it would be fine to explain the rest of the story. So how would it work, and what would be the actual impact?
Reverse pitching is something I've not heard about before myself. So I think that's a really cool idea to start with what you're critical about with your own idea and what are the risks of implementing it, especially in the healthcare sector. Sounds like a very reasonable approach to pitching. If we look now more into the methods that we can use to find scientific innovations in healthcare, what methods do you use to find scientific innovations in your day-to-day work?
I think that in science, there's no shortcut to happiness. So you have to start with good basics. So you really need to know your science. You need to know the facts, and you need to understand the phenomena and the environment you work at. And when you have a solid grounds in your knowledge, then you can also figure out what is the thing you can change, or where you can do things differently so that it still makes scientific sense.
Having talked about now scientific innovations in healthcare, what are some of the roadblocks that you encountered as a female scientist in the healthcare industry?
I mean, sometimes, especially in academia, you might end up in a group that's very male-dominated, and that will take a while before you get credibility, because it would be a lot easier to say present the same idea as a male and be taken seriously than as a female. I think it's especially a problem with the male-dominated fields, such as physics, for example.
And having heard about your story, your ideas on pitching and your roadblocks as a female scientist now in the healthcare industry, do you have some insights for us how you personally deal with such an environment? Do you have a special mindset, some recommendations, some brain foods that you would like to share with our brain foods community?
I think the main thing is to surround yourself with really good people. So find the colleagues who believe in you and who you believe in, and collaborated with open-minded people, and also try to gain self-confidence and know your science. That's always the basis of it.
That's a good ending paragraph, I think. Know your science before you get anywhere else is a great recommendation. Thank you, Jenni, for being part of this podcast. It's been a pleasure to talk to you.
Thank you so much. And it's a great series of people, and it's great to be a part of it.
Thank you so much.